One of the biggest killers of any performance engine is problems with the lubrication system. Maintaining a consistent supply of high pressure oil to all of the bearings, as well as all of the other engine components, is critical if you want any kind of reliability. Of course, when you take a factory road car engine and you put it on a racetrack with sticky slicks and you pull a lot of lateral G-force, this can be problematic. We're here with David Mountain from MounTune to talk about the development of some of their oiling systems and particular dry sump versus wet sump. So I think, David, it's fair to say that if budget is no constraint, if you want the best of the best, you go to a dry sump lubrication system. For those who aren't aware what that term even means, can you talk us through how a dry sump lubrication system works?
Okay, so basically, you know, the name gives you a clue. You're taking the oil out the bottom of the engine, you're putting it in a separate tank somewhere in the car, and what that means is that, you know, it's normally a tall tank where you can keep control of the oil. So you're always picking up oil rather than picking up air, which is what happens in a wet sump. So it's a much safer result for racing engines.
Yeah, I think that's probably a good place to just go back to. The problem really with your factory road car sump is, as you say, it's wet sump, so that means the oil is stored in the sump at the bottom of the engine, and the problem is when we've got very high lateral G-force, cornering forces, plus braking and acceleration for that matter, the oil can run away from the pickup and you suck air in, and that's where you get problems.
Yeah, and also, you know, because the oil's in the bottom of the sump, it's getting picked up with the crankshaft, you get a lot of windage and aeration going on. As you know, if you ever look at an engine on a dyno that has a perspex cover in the side of the sump, you just won't believe what's happening. It's scary. It's just a mass of froth. Yeah. And there's only a little bit of solid oil right down the bottom, which is what you've got to try and pick up.
Now, that's a good place to sort of point out that the dry sump lubrication obviously is there to ensure that you've got a constant supply of high pressure oil to the bearings, but there are some other performance advantages there from reducing, as you've just mentioned, the windage losses. So can we expect to see a power gain from going to a dry sump system as well?
Yeah, certainly. It's more noticeable on, you know, higher speed engines. So if you're running an engine at probably over 7,000 RPM, and certainly when you get up to, you know, 9,000, 10,000 RPM, you can see, I mean, typically on a 2-litre normally aspirated Ford engine, we could see 8 horsepower increase.
And when every horsepower is valuable, that's a massive difference.
Yes. Yeah, it's a big difference, yeah.
Now, let's just go through the component form of the dry sump system. So you've mentioned there's a remote reservoir that's mounted somewhere in the car. Another advantage of that, it allows you to put the reasonably significant mass of the oil exactly where you want it in the car for balance perspective. But then you've got the dry sump pump, which forms two functions. It's pumping the oil out of the engine as well as pumping the oil back into the engine from the dry sump reservoir. So you can talk to us about the scavenge side of that dry sump pump, because we hear the term sort of 4-stage, 5-stage, etc. Can you talk to us about what that means?
Yeah, you're quite right. You know, the pump or pumps are split into two different jobs. You know, there's the pressure side and then there's the scavenge side. Now, you know, whatever oil you've got in your dry sump, you've still got to pick it up. So the more scavenge pickups you can have, I mean, ultimately, if you had four, one in each corner of the pump, you're going to stand a pretty good chance of picking that oil up, drawing it out and getting it into your main tank. Because if you haven't got effective scavenge, what starts to happen is you start to lose level in your main tank and your engine starts filling up with oil. Now, it's a bit, you know, I mean, things like Formula One engines, you know, they have very complex systems. But typically, we use a two scavenge system. So one at the front, one at the back. And that works very well for most jobs.
Now, it's also probably worth mentioning here that when an engine is running, you're inevitably going to have some level of blow-by, which is the combustion pressure escaping past the rings, making its way into the crankcase. So particularly in high-performance engines, we generally end up seeing some level of positive pressure in the crankcase. But with a dry sump system, particularly with multiple scavenge stages, can you overcome that?
You certainly can, and typically on our dry sump engines, we, you know, we pull a vacuum, albeit a, you know, a fairly small depression, but we do, and we start off, you know, if you said something like you want three times the capacity from your scavenge to your pressure. That's a good starting point. I mean, we have run more 4 or 5 times. Can't say that we gain a lot from that. So you got to balance, you know, gaining power versus losing power on driving more pumps and more friction. But yeah, a small depression and 2 scavenge is a good starting point.
Now, conventionally, we normally see these dry sump pumps fitted external to the engine, which does add a layer of complexity. And one of the problems I always worry about is you've then got a rubber drive belt from the, rubber's maybe not the best term, but a drive belt nonetheless from the crankshaft pulley to your dry sump pump, which is another potential source of failure. So can you talk to us about the development of your dry sump systems? You've actually gone away from an external pump.
Yeah, I mean, over the years, we had huge problems, you know, with drivers going off into the kitty litter, you know, picking up stones, wrecking the belt, and obviously ending up, you know, with a damaged engine. So on our latest Ford Duratec-style, EcoBoost-style dry sump, all the pumps are internal. So they're chain-driven internally. There are no external pumps or drives. Much more reliable, much simple. There's just oil in and oil out. And it's been a really good way to go.
Less room for error. Now, that's all well and good. Dry sump, obviously, that's the ultimate if your class allows it, if your budget allows for it. But, of course, there are a lot of us at enthusiast level that are running lightly modified factory engines where oil surge on a racetrack is still a very big concern. Now, you've also been involved in some classes such as British Touring Car Championship where, for some interesting rule reason, they've actually stipulated you must stay with a wet sump system. What challenges does that give you, and what are the ways you can overcome that? How can you get the best possible results if you're stuck with wet sump?
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's a bit of a bone of contention, really, because we've, you know, we and other engine builders have said for a long time it's actually cheaper to go wet sump. But anyway, it's an old regulation, it's still there, and it's a major challenge. I mean, the amount of work we put into our wet sumps to get them to be reliable is immense. You know, we have all sorts of things like moving pickup pipes. We have trap doors around the oil pickup, you know, one-way valves, a big job. And occasionally on certain projects, we have to add an accusump, which is like having a big syringe of oil connected to your main oil gallery. And the minute the pressure drops, it whacks oil straight into the main oil gallery. Very simple, but very effective device.
All right, there's a few things I want to sort of go back and unpack there, because a lot of our viewers may not understand the terminology you've just used. So let's start with the oil pickup. So in a wet sump, you've got an oil pickup that's physically bolted to the underside of the oil pump, and its job, unsurprisingly, is to pick up the oil from the bottom of the sump. However, the problem is when you're running very high G-forces out on the racetrack, the oil is physically sloshing around in the sump, running away from the pickup. So you've talked about a moving pickup, and can you just tell us how does that work?
Yeah, I mean, basically the pickup pipe tries to follow the oil. Yeah. So, you know, if you've got, you know, a particular G-force, whether it be braking or accelerating, and generally we see higher G-forces under braking, you know, the oil's all trying to rush forward. Yeah. So we try and follow the oil as much as we can with a pickup pipe, yeah, rather than trying to contain it always, because, you know, at high oil temperatures, the oil is so thin, it just runs away.
So what you're basically trying to do there is always locate the pickup in the location in the sump where the oil is trying to run to.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, you've also got a little flag, kind of, I'll call it a flag, I'm not sure if there's a technical term you use internally for it, welded to the end of that pickup. So how does that help that pickup move around?
Well, it basically, obviously, the, you know, the oil is rushing to one side of the sump, and it's basically forcing, you know, it's almost like having a keel on a boat. In effect, it's forcing the pickup pipe, plus the weight of the pickup pipe, the G-force is moving it in the right direction. It just helps that.
All right, so that's the pickup there, but that's still requires you to actually try and hold the oil in the sump. And again, when you're pulling in excess of maybe 1.4, 1.5 G in a corner, the oil is physically trying to run away out of the sump. So is this where your trapdoors come in? Can you tell us how those work?
Yeah, I mean, we're running very high speed logging and very accurate, you know, pressure sensors, so we can see exactly what's happening to the oil, and we're very, very careful. You know, we're looking at dropouts on the data logging, and we've got, you know, features in the ECU where we'll only allow, you know, a dropout of a certain limit for so long before we'll go into an engine limp home or even cut the engine. So we're looking at that, and we're constantly developing to try to remove those dips. Particular circuits have particular problems. Some circuits we don't have any problems, you know. So basically, yeah, then we run, you know, trap doors, if you like, and one-way valves around the oil pickup, windage trays that try and keep the oil down below the crankshaft where it's trying to pick up the oil. It's pretty complex, and there's a lot of work that goes into it. And quite often, I mean, to be honest, one of the cheapest ways of solving this, particularly if you're on a very limited budget, is go and buy, I think, for a couple of hundred dollars, an Accusump system, whereby you haven't got to necessarily, you know, we're forced a bit down the direction because the race teams don't want to add anything, because this Accusump weighs something and it's a package space. But really, if you're running your own car and you just want a cheap and easy way of getting rid of oil surge, brilliant.
Okay, it's good that you've brought that up, the Accusump, because this is a product that we do see in the enthusiast market. It's quite popular, and it's not a product that we've personally had much experience with, so I wanted to get into that in a little bit. Now, you've already kind of mentioned it's basically like a giant syringe, but I'd like to dive in a little bit further on that. So how is the Accusump plumbed into the oil system?
It's very simply, literally, plumbed into the main oil gallery. And it's got like an air spring on one side, so you charge the system with air pressure. The idea is when you fire up the engine and you pull up the revs, basically the oil overcomes the spring pressure and it fills up the cylinder full of oil. So what happens is it's sitting there, as I say, like a big syringe. The minute the oil pressure drops on the other side, the air spring forces the oil into the main oil gallery, and you get, obviously only for a time period until it can recharge itself, but it's normally enough of a time period. You get different sizes and capacities. We tend to use the fairly small lightweight ones, but it's on capacity of oil. The bigger the capacity, the more time frame you've got. But you know, it normally gets you through the specific problem you've got, cornering, braking under that specific corner, you're out the corner, and then as you're going down the main straight, it's recharging it.
So important to mention here that this really is sort of a safety backstop, and particularly if you've got a completely stock engine that does suffer from really bad oil surge, this on its own may not be enough to save the engine, but when you start using it in conjunction with some of the other techniques that you've mentioned, it's enough to really give good reliability.
It is. I mean, if you took a pretty stock production engine, you'd pretty much get away with putting a very simple baffle in the sump, just a static simple baffle that most speed shops sell, or you could easily fabricate it yourself. With an Accusump, you're going to be in pretty good shape.
Well, I think that's some really great information for our followers out there, because a lot of enthusiasts do want to take their cars to the track. They don't want to be hurting the engine, but perhaps they don't have the several thousand dollars that a dry sump system entails. So hopefully everyone's got something out of that they can apply. Thanks for your time there, David.
No problem. Thank you very much.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.